I chose Time to Grow this year because it's been such a crazy couple of years with COVID, and having to switch last year from in-person to online sort of at the last minute was a little bit nuts, but we ended up pulling it off and it was great. There were a lot of people that were skeptical going into it, and a lot of people this year that were skeptical going into the fact that it's another online conference, but I think I proved myself last year that I can run a conference even online on Zoom and have it be really interactive and really fun and have people learn a lot. And I didn't get any negative feedback from last year's conference at all. Everybody said it was amazing and that they learned so much and they didn't feel like they were even online. And so I think that's something where this year, with the theme of Time to Grow, we're all ready to kind of move forward and get past this pandemic. And we all know that we still have some things and some time that we have to get through before we're completely through it.
Disinformation is spreading.
There will be a surprise outbreak. Is the issue of pandemic.
No social distancing at all.
They said that they would express their concerns about the mask supply.
Where's the mask? Where's the glove?
A second wave is
we all need some good news.
A message for all the healthcare workers out there.
Thank you.
From Santa Rosa, California, this is 19 Stories. I'm Cheryl Holling. My guest, Val Kelly, is a bilingual English and French actor, entrepreneur, wife, mother, and podcast producer and host of the Live with Squawky podcast. Her voiceover career includes voicing toys from the FurRealFriends series of toys, the voice of Fuzzy in a film by the same name, various cartoon characters, and pretty much anything character-based. In addition to being a voice actress, Val is the owner, president, CEO, executive producer of Mid-Atlantic Voiceover, LLC, and is the executive producer for the Mid-Atlantic Voiceover Conference, affectionately known as MAVO, which she launched in 2014. Since its inception, Val has planned and hosted conferences in person from 2015 through 2018, with last year's and the upcoming 2021 conference taking place virtually online. The MAVO conference has grown from 28 original attendees in 2014 to over 165 in 2020 and promises to be even larger with this November's conference. Add to that being a full-time French teacher and you've got one busy woman. Let's meet this dynamo by welcoming Val Kelly to 19 Stories.
Thanks so much for having me.
Thanks so much for being here. I really appreciate it because obviously in reading that, one would wonder how you even have time to sit down and chat with me. So how are you doing today?
I'm good. I'm so excited for this weekend. I'm just really like ready to go. It's exciting, an exciting time.
Well, tell me what you got. We're going to jump into some bunch of questions, but tell me, because I happen to know you. We were sharing it with me while we were chitty-chatting before, but I happen to know what's going on this weekend. Why don't you share?
Yeah, so the voiceover barbecue, Uncle Roy's voiceover barbecue is happening this weekend. So I'm heading up to New Jersey tomorrow morning early, driving, and I'm going to go help him get set up for it and just kind of have a chance to visit with him a little bit because Uncle Roy and I are really close and he's been a great friend over the years. So it's been a couple of years since I've seen him. So I'm really excited to go and catch up with him and see all my voiceover friends in person. And tomorrow night, I'm going into New York City to meet my brother and my niece who just turned 21. So we're going to go to a really fancy dinner in the city and I'm staying overnight in the city. And so I haven't been into New York City in a couple of years. And so obviously, since COVID and everything. So yeah, it's exciting to get to go away and have a break from school and have a break from my family for a minute. Just I love them, but you know what I mean?
Like, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So, yeah. And for those who are not familiar with who Uncle Roy is, can you share who is Uncle Roy?
So Uncle Roy Yokelson is our everyone's favorite voiceover tech guy in the industry. He's been in the industry for such a long time, and he is the guy to go to for your demo production and any kind of technical issues that you have with your audio recordings and things like that. He's great at teaching editing for Adobe Audition and just an all-around great guy, just so generous with his time. And he produced my commercial demo for me, and we just have really become good friends over the years, and he just is a really special person to me. So yeah.
Well, shout out to Uncle Roy. I think it's wonderful that you're getting to go into the city and then getting to go see Uncle Roy, who lives in New Jersey. And, you know, speaking of COVID and, you know, not traveling out, it's got to be incredibly exciting to be able to be with people again. Where are you speaking to me from? And what, if any, are your current COVID directives?
So I'm in my home studio in Fredericksburg, Virginia, and we don't have to wear masks in stores unless we want to. So we've been through like a lot of phases, just like the rest of the country has, where it was mandatory, and then we kind of went through a phase where it wasn't mandatory, and now it's kind of not mandatory, but a lot of people are wearing masks again. But then in school, it is mandatory, so like teachers and students have to wear masks, and pretty much everybody wears them, I would say, going into a lot of the stores and stuff, but I'd say it's a little bit less than when it was like, you have to do it. You know what I mean? It's not as bad as it was. I don't think we're really in a super hot zone where I am, but it's still happening, you know? So people are just kind of trying to cope with it.
Thank you for sharing about what's going on in your particular part of the country, because of course, as you say, it's different everywhere. And I want to talk with you about your voice work as a voice actor. But before we do that, I'm curious, given that in addition to all the aforementioned activities and responsibilities that you have, how did you get into French, teaching French, and how long have you been teaching French?
Well, this is my 23rd year of teaching French full time.
Wow.
And it's been a really long time. But I got into it when I was living in upstate New York with my parents for a little bit. When I got out of college, I was trying to figure out what to do with my life. I knew I went to school for teaching. Like, I went to go study French. And then basically what happened, and I've told the story a bunch of times, but this is kind of funny. When I was in my junior year of college, I had just come back from living in the south of France for 6 months. And my advisor, who was like my dad in college, sat me down and he goes, okay, you know, Val, it's your junior year. You're about to be a senior. You've just lived in France for a while, and you really need to decide what you're going to do with French. And I go, okay, speak it. And he goes, okay, well, speaking French, no one's going to pay you for that. Like, that's not a career. And I was like, well, you know, like, I don't know, just go live in France. And he goes, that's not a job. And I was like, oh, man. So you know how you are in college, like, you just don't totally think it all the way through all the time, you know? And so I honestly, looking back on it, don't really know what I planned to actually do with it. So he goes, okay, you have basically two choices. You can go into education, which is probably a good option for you, or you can go into the international business side. And he goes, let's get real. Your math skills are not what they need to be to do international business, simply for the fact that you really need a lot of math classes for it. And math is just not my strength. And so that's okay. Not everyone is great at math. But he was like, so basically, you can go study teaching. And I was like, okay, well, I didn't really like school that much the first time around. But okay, I'll just, let's do that. So that was kind of how it started initially. But then once I started taking, once I did my student teaching, I quickly ruled out elementary school. And even though I really like little kids, I was like, I can't deal with their energy level. It's too much. And I can't plan that much stuff to do. It would drive me crazy. So I ruled out elementary school. Middle school, I was there for one day and I was like, oh, no. These kids are mad. Like, no, just no. And so it was a very easy process for me to realize that high school was where I should be. And I just could relate to the students, and they liked the way that I taught. And it was just really an easy transition for me to do. And so when I did my student teaching for high school, I was like, this is what I want to do. And, you know, if I'm going to be a teacher, this is the level I want to be at. And so that's how it started. And then when I finally got a job offer in Central New York, I taught in a school, a very rural school in a town called Verona. It was like Vernon Verona Sherrill High School, and it was about 800 students. And so that was my first teaching experience. It was a very small school, and I was the only French teacher. And it was a great experience because teaching in New York State, you have such a great teachers union, and they're really supportive. And especially as a teacher starting out, it's a great place to be because you have the support system that you need to kind of figure out your way in the teaching system. It can be very political, so it's kind of tough starting out. And then along the way, I met who eventually became my husband, Rob. And so he was living in Virginia, or we were going to move to Virginia. He was living in Baltimore. And so he didn't want to move to New York because his job was going to make more money. So the only logical thing to do was for me to move south. And so that's when I moved to Virginia. And then I started teaching in Prince William County. And I've been there ever since. So this is my 20th year in Prince William County teaching French. And I love it. I mean, there are definitely ups and downs of teaching. I mean, there have been years when I'm like, oh, man, I don't know if I can do this anymore. You know, last year was probably one of those years where everything was virtual and it was really tough to teach French online. But I love teaching French because I love the language and I love the culture and I love sharing that with the students. And I love the fact that there's a possibility that it will generate enthusiasm in someone else to be able to learn another language. So that's kind of why I keep doing it.
And you obviously are very good at it because you have a passion for it. Otherwise, you know, to do anything consistently and do it well for 23 years is really something to be proud of. And I understand that you're now back teaching in person. And I'm wondering if there are any challenges with re-engaging with students in person after teaching them online for the past year and a half.
I think there's a lot of challenges going back in person after that, because these kids that are, you know, sophomores this year that only ever had their first year of high school online, and then they had their eighth grade year kind of also disrupted. They haven't really had to be in a normal classroom setting, a normal in air quotes, right? But the challenges that I'm facing this year so far are just that they don't know how to focus on what we're actually doing. You know, it's like, we'll say stuff, I'll say directions for something, and they're like, 5 seconds later, what do we do? I literally just explained to you what we're doing. Although I don't know if that's so different from what kids normally do. I just don't remember anymore. You know,
I was going to say, yeah. I seem to recall those days.
I know. It's like, I literally just explained it to you. And it's so frustrating, you know, but I think it's just when it was virtual last year, it was super frustrating. You couldn't do anything you wanted to do for French. It was just crazy, you know, just trying to just navigate your way through Zoom calls and stuff. And there was such a lack of connection with the students, and now they're in person and it's so much better because you get to see them in person, you know, even though they're half of their face is covered with a mask, which, by the way, is also kind of weird because you don't actually know what people look like with their mask on. And this, for some reason, isn't something I realized in the real world outside of teaching, because, you know, with your family, of course, you see them without a mask, and a lot of other people see without a mask, but your students, you don't really see without a mask. So the other day, somebody had their mask down for something, like just for a minute, you know, and I was like, oh, that's what your nose looks like. Of course, I didn't say that, but it's weird sometimes, you know, like,
these are the weird things
you encounter. It's like, oh, I didn't expect your nose to look like that. Obviously, you're not going to say it to a kid, but I thought that was kind of funny. It's like, yeah.
Well, the other thing that with language, at least, you know, and this is going to sound really strange to someone who doesn't wear glasses. I wear glasses for long distance. And certainly when I'm speaking to someone, I will wear glasses because I didn't realize how much I watch a person's mouth when they're speaking. And sometimes, as strange as it sounds, if I'm not understanding someone, I put on my glasses so I can hear them. Now, again, that goes back to reading someone's lips. So when you're speaking not only in English, but now you're speaking in a new language and teaching a new language. I mean, I didn't even anticipate asking you this, but do you find more challenges in trying to teach French when they either can't see your mouth or you can't see your students' mouths?
Yeah, it's definitely challenging to teach pronunciation because they really do sometimes have to see your lips and the way your mouth is kind of moving and forming those sounds. So sometimes I'll stand super far away from them, as far as I can away from them, and I'll just pull my mask down and be like, I just need you guys to see my face for a second, you know,
Yes, because
I don't know what else to do. It's like, how else am I supposed to, like, I could get a face shield. That's so dumb. Like, it's just, those are the challenges we're facing. You could get a face shield. You could get a clear mask. Those are weird. I'm not going to do that. They have these like weird plastic masks that like
show just your
lips. And I'm like, I can't do that. It's just so strange.
Yeah, it is definitely kind of weird. One of the reasons I'm asking you about your teaching, besides wanting to give praise for all the hard work and adjustments you and all teachers have had to endure this past year, but also to ask you as a mom, how have you taught other students full-time in addition to having your own children at home that I imagine required tutelage?
Yeah, definitely. Last year being virtual was challenging because, you know, with having the girls home and my daughters are in, well, last year they were in fourth and seventh grade. Now they're in fifth and eighth. I have to think about it sometimes because I can't remember even anymore what grade they're in. So I'm like, what grade are you in? Fourth? Sixth?
Are you one of my kids?
Are you Maddie or are you Chloe? Which one are you? Yeah. So I'm very fortunate because my daughters, even though they are very young still, they're very self-sufficient and they're very independent. And I've kind of taught them to be that way. And so, of course, they needed my help on certain things. And of course, I would help them, or my husband would if they needed help with their work. But they were, for more of the year, they were in a hybrid format than my school was. So they were going like 2 days a week from a good portion of the year. There were times when they were completely virtual, but they were more in school than I was. And then I think starting in February of last school year, we went back to a hybrid format. So I was in the classroom every day, and my students, I had maybe like five people in the class with me sometimes. And then some classes I didn't have any kids if they chose to stay virtual. So it's definitely challenging balancing my time with the teaching of my own students versus teaching my own children. But like I said, I'm lucky that they're just smart girls. So I feel very fortunate that I didn't have that much I had to do to help them. So that was good.
Well, I'm sure they haven't fallen far from the tree. And
they fell closer to the math tree with my husband, though.
That's okay. At least they got it, right? That's okay. That's all right. I'm sure they have many wonderful qualities about them that did come from their mom. So it's clear that French and working with kids is a passion for you. And by now, people can hear that you have a very unique and distinctive voice. And given you've been working with kids all these years, how, if at all, did that lead you into the world of voiceover?
Well, I wouldn't say that working with kids led me into voiceover necessarily, because the voiceover thing kind of started when I was really young. I always played games with my dad when I was a kid that were kind of improv games that I didn't realize were improv games at the time. And then as I got older, people said, when I went to college, especially, they were like, oh, you have a really unique voice. I mean, people always said that. They were like, oh, your voice is so cute. You should do something with that. And I'm like, I don't know what that means, because what am I going to do with it? You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's my voice.
Speak French.
Yeah, exactly.
That's not a job, apparently. So
apparently to your dad, no.
Yeah. And so when I kind of fell into voiceover, when my dad found an intro to voiceover class for me, and he said, hey, this class, you should go to it, and, you know, because it would be great for you to just check it out and see if you can do something with it. And you love acting and you love playing with your voice and doing characters, and it's just so natural for you, so go check it out. So I did. And that's kind of how I got started in voiceover. And I, you know, did a little bit of training with this company, and then didn't really know what to do with my demo, and then it sat on a shelf for a bunch of years. So I don't know that really working with students necessarily had any place in the voiceover. It was almost kind of completely separate.
Maybe a more apropos question was how you entered into the world of voiceover. And I was just thinking, with you being surrounded by kids and the playfulness, that maybe that kind of lent a hand into you wanting to explore just kind of playing a little bit more. And now that you explained that your father, by the way, sounds very hip, you know, really. I mean, he sounds like a great mentor. He sounds like someone who is a little forward thinking and playing these improv games with you and encouraging you to take a voiceover class. So shout out to Dad.
Yeah, he was great. Yeah.
I mentioned earlier some of the toys and cartoons that you have voiced for, and I happen to know that you have a new animation demo in the works. So in addition to animation toys and cartoons, are there other genres within the voiceover world that you would like to explore?
Well, I've done a little bit of children's e-learning in French and in English, but I haven't really explored it very much just because of time constraints and because I just have been so focused on the character-based stuff because that's mostly what I book. So I mean, I think that it would be a good genre. I think children's e-learning especially would be something that would be really helpful for me. And then also I could do it in French as well. So I think I need to take some training on it because I really don't know the techniques and things like that, that I think would help me to book more e-learning work. And so that's definitely a genre that I'd like to explore more.
Yeah, I would think that would be a natural for you. And anytime someone's bilingual, that opens up worlds of possibilities that it doesn't for other people. And I have heard one of your e-learning demos on your website, and it's just a perfect niche for you. It really is wonderful for you. And how does because you mentioned time constraints, and, you know, in just listening to the intro and everything that you're involved in, we'll get to MAVO in a moment, because that in and of itself is its own living, breathing entity. But how does your podcast, Live with Squawky, fit in with your own voice effort? So maybe you can, for those who haven't heard Live with Squawky, what is the premise of your podcast and how does that either fit in with or complement your own voice efforts?
Well, I started Live with Squawky when I wanted to start a YouTube channel. I thought it would be a great idea to just interview other voice actors in the industry. And I really just feel so passionate about voiceover and helping other actors, and I wanted to have a platform to be able to, I don't know, I just really like talking to other people and I wanted to kind of share the positivity that I like to incorporate in my life on a show and have people be able to share their stories. And so that's kind of how it started, was just on a YouTube format with video. And then after about 2.5 seasons on YouTube and a lot of video editing, which was interesting, I decided from the recommendation of a lot of people that I should just make it into an audio podcast because it would be easier to edit and it wouldn't take so much time. And I don't know if that's totally true. It still takes a lot of time.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just so fun to be able to have the chance to talk with people about what they do and how they got started. And I like to keep it really light and fun and just talk about things like what they're, you know, who their favorite superheroes are and what they would have as a superpower if they could have one, and if they drink coffee or not. And if they don't, I try not to hold it against them and, you know, things like that. Yeah.
You mean you don't end the interview right there? I mean, I think that would be like the interview ender of all, you know, answers. No, I don't drink coffee, Val.
I know. Sometimes I don't know what to say when people say, no, they don't. I'm like so floored. I'm like, what? You don't drink coffee? And like Mark Scott, I was interviewing Mark Scott, and I remember this because I was like, okay, you have to be like very, very polite here. But he's like, no, I hate coffee. And he just went on this whole spiel about how he hates the smell of it and all this stuff and how he drinks Dr. Pepper and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, okay. I'm going to try not to hold this against you and end the interview right now. And he was just like, geez, Val. And I was like, Mark, you know who you're talking to, right? Like, just lie and say that you like coffee. It'd make the interview much more interesting. And he was like, I'm not going to lie on your show.
I think it's a cultural thing, too, because if you're speaking to someone from the UK, more than likely, now, this is not to say all Brits are teetotalers, but more than likely you're going to hear about, you know, the afternoon tea than you are going to hear about coffee. But yes,
Great
Britain do drink coffee. So
I do expect that from people from the UK, but I don't know. Mark's not American. He's Canadian, but still, there's no excuse.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you would understand if he drank tea, because there is the British influence in Canada, depending on what part of, well, he's in Toronto, but Dr. Pepper, yeah. Okay, so moving on, Mark, I think every, you know, if you're listening, everybody loves you, but we'll forgive you for not drinking coffee.
We love you, Mark.
Love you, Mark. Now, Mark Scott, actually, if you could just, Mark Scott is another major voiceover talent, marketer, entrepreneur, and someone that everybody within the voiceover realm either has worked with or knows of and has his own podcast, respectively. So Mid-Atlantic Voiceover, you just spoke to where Live with Squawky kind of was birthed from, what were your impetus for doing that. To take that to another level, a higher realm, if you will, of actually creating a networking platform and conference, that's in and of itself its own entity for so many people. Forget everything else you're doing. So can you speak to the scope of what MAVO is? And like I said, given that it is its own huge undertaking, how do you manage to juggle this with all your other responsibilities, Val?
Wow, it's crazy. It's really crazy, actually. It's something I do because I love it so much. And I started it from an idea that I had. And just, I was actually traveling to France with one of my friends, Zach. And I said, wouldn't it be cool if I just, you know, started my own company? And he's like, yeah, that would be cool. So we had like this 9-hour flight to Paris or something. And I'm like, what do you think of this? And he's not in voiceover at all. And I just said, I don't want to work for someone else forever, you know? That was a good part of it, too, was like, I want to be the person in charge. I want to be able to do and hire who I want to hire and learn from who I want to learn from. So to a certain degree, it was a little bit selfish on that side of it. But at the same time, it was really something that I decided to do because I wanted to offer the possibility for people to train with the best voice actors and industry pros in the country in the DC, Virginia, Northern Virginia area. And so it's something that over time has become kind of more manageable, but it's grown over the years. So there are many different aspects of the business part of it that I've had to learn and try to figure out and make a lot of mistakes and still, you know, I'm still learning every day from it. But I think I just really wanted to be able to bring people together in, you know, in one location to just be able to say, like, we're not just gonna go somewhere and sit and listen to people talk about voiceover. We're gonna actually go and do it. So I want people to feel like they can come to the sessions and really have the chance to perform instead of just sitting there and listening to someone talk about it. You know, mm-hmm. I don't think it's as effective if you have someone who comes in and talks about their career and what they've done, because that's only one part of it, right? So we're all trying to figure out how to get better and how to do better and how to book more work and how to improve our skills, right? And so if you just have someone come in and talk about, well, this is what I've done and that's what I've done and look how successful I am, it's not as good as if you have someone come in and go, yes, this is what I've done and this is what I did to get here. And now these are the skills that you need to have that I can teach you to be able to get to that next level in your career. Do you know what I mean?
That's one of the things that when you listen to, quote, influencers of, I did this, that, and the other, and you're like, okay, that's wonderful. How did you do that? And as you say, you apply it to voiceover. How do I do that? There's nothing like getting behind a mic and reading copy and getting direction and conversely hearing other people, because think of how much we learn watching and hearing other people and how they interpret copy or they interpret a character or develop a character. And I love that you had a friend who was not in the business, because sometimes getting someone who is objective and not, this may sound counterintuitive, but emotionally connected in the same business you're in, sometimes they can ask you questions that you wouldn't think of because you're so excited about just the idea in and of itself. And he obviously helped you process some things on your flight to France that birthed MAVO. And I'm curious, when you were launching it, was there an element of fear in doing so?
I think there definitely was, but I was so determined to make it happen. I'm a very, very driven person. That's something that my dad instilled in me as a kid, was just go after your dreams, no matter what they are, and do whatever you have to do to make them happen. And so obviously a big part of it was because I wanted to start my own company. You know, I wanted to prove that I could do it in spite of being afraid of doing it, you know. But then there were just so many things at the beginning that I didn't know how to do. You know what I mean? I didn't really know how to advertise for a conference. I didn't know how to make all the ads that you have to make. I didn't know how to design a website. I didn't know how to do like any of that stuff. So I remember the first website, which was probably really horrible. My friend Zach, who I bounced the idea off of, what he's an IT person. So I was like, okay, I'm going to need you to come over and help me fix this so it looks like okay. And so we spent, I mean, just countless hours on the site, getting it set up, figuring it out, and then just updating it and updating it and updating it, you know, and then just improving it. And then over the years, I had a web designer go in and kind of fix it, and then had a graphic designer do like the logo and stuff like that. And so it improved over the years, but it is such, having your own business is such a learning process. And I don't think a lot of people realize that. I think some people are like, yeah, I'm going to have my own business. And being a voice actor is having your own business. So there are all those different facets to it. But this is on another level when you're talking about a company that runs a conference, because
yes,
it's not just those things like advertising and marketing and the website and all of that. It's also like your relationship with the people in the industry. Are they going to want to be hired by you, and negotiating contracts with all of them, and then trying to figure out the logistics of putting a schedule together for the event. And there's just so many different things to it. Now I have people that kind of help me here and there along the way, or at least they're like my support system. I have a real good support system of people who, if I really just get overwhelmed, I'm like, hey, can you do this or can you do that? But for the most part, I do almost all of it by myself. I have people help with like the retweeting and the sharing and the, you know, newsletters and the stuff like that that go out. But I write it all myself and do all of that myself, just because I'm not good at delegating. So that's
that's honest. And that's actually really remarkable. You know, that is, Val, to have this kind of undertaking where you are, like you say, bringing everybody together in a cohesive manner where people are going to learn and grow, which I'm going to segue into the title of your upcoming conference, Time to Grow. I would love for you to just share a bit about your upcoming conference, what you're excited about, and what people can look forward to by attending it.
Yeah, so our upcoming conference is on November 11th through 14th, actually, because we added a session on the 11th. So it's not a full day on the 11th, it's just at night. We just added an agents panel. So the agents from AB Squared Talent, as well as the La Lapidus Company, will be there to be on a panel. So attendees will be able to ask them questions and get all their most burning questions for agents out of the way. And I think that's so exciting, because we've never had an agents panel at the conference before. So this is something that is really brand new. And it's exciting because all the people that are the agents on the panel are my agents. So that's also fun. But also kind of nerve-wracking. Yeah, they're very sweet and saying things like, you know, we're very proud of you for doing this whole thing and putting it all together. And, you know, and I'm like, well, if I don't audition that much from now until November, this is why. And they're like, we got you.
I think they'd understand. Yes.
Yeah. So that's something I'm really excited about. But then, yeah, I mean, the theme is time to grow. And so I chose that theme this year instead of our normal get inspired theme, which is what we use when we do the in-person conference. It's always been get inspired, because that, of course, is what I want people to do, is get inspired by all the people that I hire to come in and teach them. And I chose time to grow this year because it's been such a crazy couple of years with COVID, and having to switch last year from in-person to online sort of at the last minute was a little bit nuts, but we ended up pulling it off and it was great. There was a lot of people.
You did a really good job, by the way. You did a great job.
Oh, thank you. There were a a lot of people that were skeptical going into it, and a lot of people this year that were skeptical going into the fact that it's another online conference. But I think I proved myself last year that I can run a conference even online on Zoom and have it be really interactive and really fun and have people learn a lot. And I didn't get any negative feedback from last year's conference at all. Everybody said it was amazing and that they learned so much and they didn't feel like they were even online. And so I think that's something where this year, with the theme of time to grow, we're all ready to kind of move forward and get past this pandemic. And we all know that we still have some things and some time that we have to get through before we're completely through it. But I just chose people as guest speakers this year that I really knew would be inspiring and that would be able to teach classes that are interactive and performance-based so that attendees feel like they're going into, especially the breakout sessions, and having the chance to learn new skills and perform right then and there and get feedback from these amazing coaches that in real life, outside of a conference setting, you would pay anywhere from $150 plus for 1 hour with these people. And for a conference that's so well priced, and you get, we have 27 guest speakers this year. I mean, it's just, it's
that's
like,
phenomenal. It
it's
really
crazy
is phenomenal.
When you say it out loud, honestly. I look at it and I'm like, this is nuts. You know, and what's really cool too is just that we have so many people from like the UK and people from all over the United States too. And realistically, to have all those people fly in for an in-person event, it just wouldn't be possible. It's not in our budget to do that. And so having people like, you know, we have on our animation panel by itself, we have our keynote, Jennifer Hale, who's been named the most prolific video game voice actor by Guinness World Records. And she's
really?
Also...
I didn't know that.
Yeah. And she's also the founder of a site called Skills Hub. And they do coaching for actors. So say you have like an audition coming up or something and you need a little extra practice, a little extra guidance, you can schedule a session with them and they're really affordable and you can hop on with like a really awesome coach and they'll help you get prepped for like your audition or they'll help you get prepped on a new skill that you want to learn, like you want to learn a new dialect or something like that. You can schedule a session with a coach that specializes in that. And so that's really cool that she's the founder of that. So that's pretty awesome in itself. But then we have great people like Jonathan Tilley, who is a personal brand strategist from, he's actually American, but he lives, I think, in Germany, but he might be in Spain now. It's hard to tell. He's somewhere in Europe.
He travels a lot. Yeah.
Yeah. And then we have Diane Perry, who just wrote her own book, which is amazing. And she's going to be teaching classes on narration and how to kind of just figure out where you're having issues and how to solve them and how to audition better and how to get out of your head and just kind of be able to perform better so that you can move forward and book more work, you know. And then we also have Jamie B. Chambers, who's from the UK as well. And he's also an on-screen actor. So he's doing one session that's talking about the difference between similarities and differences between on-screen acting and voiceover, which I thought was so cool. But he's also doing a breakout session. He's offering it twice, which is really cool, on like dialects and character breakdowns. And he just has an amazing accent and he does lots of like martial arts outside of voiceover. And he's just a really cool guy. So I'm excited to have those people that, like I said, in person, we might not be able to fly all of them in. Like we also have Noemi Vox, who is, she lives in Wales. So we have like a good representation from the UK and we have, oh my gosh, it just keeps going. I'm like, there's a couple more people from the UK. There's Nick Redmond and Leah Marks who are doing a special session on podcasting, which is also really cool. So I'm trying to see if I got everybody from the UK. There's a lot. There's a lot of people from the UK. It's really funny. I heard all the Brits this year.
The British are coming. And you know what's really cool about you mentioning Nick Redmond and Leah Marks is today, as I'm interviewing you, not when this airs, but is International Podcast Day. And they were guests in the Voices in Podcasting room that we did on Clubhouse today with Angan Guza and Jody Krangle. And they are a hoot. Their energy alone is worth the price of admission. They just... really just powerhouse women, dynamic energy, very witty, have great information to share. So you have a really eclectic lineup, and we're going to have some information in the show notes. And before we close out, you'll tell people where they can get a hold of you and find out more about MAVO. And it's clear, Val, that it seems like whatever you touch your hand to, and it seems like your father had a huge influence, as you say, to just really be bold and approach the things that you want to do. And even if you're fearful, to push through that and do it anyway. And if you had to pick one of your greatest achievements, professionally or otherwise, what would it be?
Oh, gosh. I mean, I guess this could go in two different directions, right? Personally, it would be having my daughters. That was a huge achievement in itself. I am so happy and proud to be a mom because they're so just beautiful. You know, I look at them every day and I'm like, I can't believe they're mine. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, that's wonderful.
Just very cool to be a mom. But I think professionally, MAVO is my baby. It's one of the things I'm most proud of in my whole life that I've done. And it just seems like with time and experience and more training, it just keeps getting better and better. So I feel like it can only just keep getting better and better. And I feel like my dad did really have such a huge influence on my life. And I know that he passed away in 2009, but I know that he would be so proud of me now if he was able to be here for it. You know what I mean? Like, if,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, just so like the live with Squacky and the conference and like everything I do with like the duck logo and everything, that's all kind of a shout out to my dad because he helped me to be who I am today and I would not be who I am today without him. So, yeah.
Thank you for sharing that. I think he would be very, very proud of you, Val. And I lost my father in 2009 as well. And he is an influence in me finally launching my podcast and telling people stories because that's part of what he did in his life as well. And conversely, if you had a less than successful time that informed you of the next right step, what would that be?
I think just I've made some mistakes in my life that have to do with trusting people that I shouldn't have trusted. So it's on a more personal level of just sometimes being a really nice person can kind of like be a bad thing as well. Like it can be a negative thing because I ended up trusting somebody in my life who really did a number on me and it taught me some really harsh lessons that I had to learn. And looking back on it, it's like if I had, you know, made better decisions, then those things that happened wouldn't have happened. But that's definitely something in my life that was, you know, a really tough time for me to get through. And I think what I've learned from it is just that you can still be a really nice person and just be more careful with who you let into your life and just not everyone is trustworthy. So you have to really try to figure out a way to gauge whether people really should be allowed to be in your life or not.
Perfectly said. Yeah, I was going to say that I would hope that you wouldn't dim your light in all who you are and how nice you are and giving and everything else that I know the Val Kelly to be. Because that, you know, sometimes people are put in our lives to give us the lessons we need to learn. And, you know, it's their loss, really. I mean, they are hurtful lessons. They are. I can absolutely hear what you're saying. And thank you for sharing what came out of that for you. And I'm curious what makes you hopeful.
Oh, gosh. I think there's so much to be hopeful for. But what makes me hopeful? Let's see. Just having a positive attitude and having a positive mindset. And I don't know, really. I just try to live my life with the outlook that whatever is meant to happen is going to happen. And I just try to stay really positive no matter what. If I kind of see myself falling into that like negative side, I, you know, get my dog and I'm like, I need some hugs. Cosmo, he's like the best dog
Cosmo,
ever.
Cosmo, I
yeah,
love that name.
He's so
I
great.
Love that name.
And it's so funny. Like it sounds weird. Maybe it doesn't. I'm sure people relate to this, but if you have a dog and you're close to it, it's like you can just be feeling horrible and then you'll just go like give them a hug and everything is like suddenly better. You know what I mean? It's just one of those things where he just has that ability to just calm me down and be like, without words, it's going to be okay. You're going to be fine. You can do this. You know, before the podcast, whenever I do an episode and if I'm nervous or something like that, I just go in and spend a little time with Cosmo and he's like, it's going to be fine. You're going to be great. You're going to do great. Go. Just do it. You know? And so he keeps me kind of hopeful. Yeah. I know that's kind of a weird thing to say about a dog, but I don't know. Yeah.
It's not at all. I mean, animals do give us unconditional love. And I don't think that's, you know, that's why there are therapy pets, because there's a unspoken bond and love between your owner and, I hate to even say owner, I think of them as family members when you have fur babies. I'll just call them fur babies.
Yeah.
Getting love from your fur baby. So Val, if there was a soundtrack to your life, what would be on it and why?
Gosh, I don't know. Let me think about this for a second.
It's okay. You've got all the time that you want because we can edit the space
edit
out.
The silence. So by soundtrack, do you mean like a specific song or...
Well, it could be a series of songs. Like if you think about your life and it could be in stages, like, you know, when I was younger, this particular song meant something to me. It could be a tone. Like, would it be jazz music? Would it be classical? Would it be French music? Edith Piaf? It could be anything. It could be eclectic mix, whatever that means for you.
Okay. I think mine would be, I would have to say the Rainbow Connection then. Because when I was little, that was the song that my dad and I always used to sing from the Muppets.
Oh, that's so sweet. That's so sweet. Yes, I know it.
Yeah. And so every time we would watch a Muppet movie and that song would, you know, whatever one, if that song was in, I feel like it was in multiple of them. But whenever that would come on, it was just our song, you know, and it was just, even now when I hear it, I get kind of teared up because I'm like, Dad, you know, so that would probably be it. For sure.
That is so sweet. That's the first time I've had that answer. And it's really beautiful expression of your relationship with your dad. And finally, how can people get a hold of you?
Oh, well, I'm everywhere. So.
Okay. Well, that. Thank you very much, Val. That wraps up our time together.
I'm just kidding. So you can check out my website at valkellyvoiceover.com. That's my personal voiceover website. And then you can check out the company website at midatlanticvo.com, as well as find me on Facebook and LinkedIn at Val Kelly. And you can also find me on Instagram and Twitter at Squacky Voice, at Live with Squacky, and at Mid-Atlantic VO. I think I got them all. Yeah.
Not missing anything, I think so. Am I? If you have, I'll have it in the show notes. And is there anything else you would like to share or say before we say goodbye and send you off into New York City?
Oh, gosh, I almost forgot about that. I'm so excited.
That's pretty funny.
Well, thanks so much for having me on the show. It was so much fun to talk with you. And I hope that I'll see everybody, including you, at MAVO 2021 on November 12th through 14th. It's going to be a great event. And I would really love for all of you guys to check it out and go register today.
Wonderful. Val, thank you for your time. I hope you have a fantabulous time in New York City and at Uncle Roy's barbecue. Tell them all hello, eat some great food, just rip a song on the karaoke. I understand that's a big part of the barbecue. And we want live footage. You got to do a live stream.
Yeah, I'm going to do an Instagram live. So yeah, I'm not really super familiar with doing Instagram Live. I've done a couple, but we'll see how it goes. Because, you know, it's a little crazy at his house. It does get a little crazy.
Well, Val Kelly, thank you so much for your time and for gracing us with your presence in the midst of everything you got going on. I wish you a super successful time to grow. Again, everything will be in the show notes. Check out MAVO if you're not familiar with it. If you are not, you know, have always wondered about voiceover and wanted to enter the world, this would be a really great way to dip your toes in the water and get an idea of everything from business to coaching and script interpretation, laughter, Yeah, it's a really super event to attend. And hopefully, as Val said, we'll see you all there. So you take care of yourself, my dear.
Thank you. You too. Thanks so much, Cheryl.
You're welcome, Val.
I'd also like to thank the following news outlets for the use of their clips in so aptly painting the picture of the fear that we're facing during this pandemic. BBC, PBS, Now This, UNESCO, and Some Good News. I especially want to thank Joel and Luke Smallbone, otherwise known as the group For King and Country, for allowing me to use an excerpt of their song Together, which could not be a more hopeful and inspiring song for such a time as this. Finally, I'll leave you with the following from Proverbs 23:18. Surely there is a future, and your hope will not be cut off. Thank you again for joining me today. Feel free to offer feedback or a story idea at 19stories@soundsatchelstudios.com. Visit my website at soundsatchelstudios.com. Via Instagram at Cheryl Holling VO. I look forward to sharing more stories on the next episode of 19 Stories From Fear to Hope. Until then, stay healthy and hopeful.
Together with our differences, together we are bolder, braver, stronger.